It's Wednesday night, and we are in a study on our inheritance. It's amazing how many subjects this word inheritance has to do with. When you just stop and think, just common, simple thinking, you just say the word inherit, what comes to your mind? Well, comes to your mind is a last will and testament, because you don't inherit something unless there's been a last will and testament drawn up. Right? Right. A last will and testament. You think of sons if you're involved in a testament or in to inherit something. And you think of how or who are sons. And you think of how do you partake of a last will and testament. How to partake of it. And this last will and testament, you think of a family, don't you? You think, what family is this? And who's the patriarch? And who's going to die? And who's going to leave us something in this family? I've got a son named Eric, and he will inherit mine and Mary's, whatever we have left when we die. But he can't have it till we're dead. You got to wait, Eric. You can't walk in and say, I want my inheritance. There was a young man that did that in the Bible. He said, I want my inheritance. And his father gave him his inheritance. He went out and spent it and blew it on wild living and ended up in a pig pen with some hogs and eating husk with the hogs. And he came back to his father. There's been this prodigal son. There's been much said about whether he was a believer or not. Well, first of all, he was a son, wasn't he? And he was given an inheritance, and he went out and squandered it, but he came back home to his father. So this shows that a person can be a believer, be in the family, and can wander off and go astray. And yet God will call us all back. Now, I've gone astray. Is anybody going astray besides me? People say, well, you can't live like that if you're a believer. Yes, you can. Not only that, but you have to be developed into being a mature believer. You start off your life with a little faith. Jesus kept telling the apostles, oh, ye of little faith. Well, faith has to grow according to 2 Peter 1 and 5. And Paul says, Peter said, you have to add to your faith. And the apostles said, Lord, increase our faith. Well, if you need to increase faith, then your faith will grow. Well, some people say, well, you get all the faith you need. Well, the Bible says you have to add to it. And if you add to it, then you'll come to a place where you'll never fall, and you'll make your calling and election sure by adding to your faith. And people say, well, sure means to be positive. No, that doesn't mean that. There's seven things that you have to add to your faith. Seven things. Starts off with virtue there in the 2 Peter, this has to do with our inheritance. This is part of our inheritance. 2 Peter, the first chapter, besides all this, give all diligence, add to your faith, and it names seven things. Well, seven is the number of divine refinement all through the Bible. You got sevens all through Revelation, seven seals, seven trumpets, seven vials, seven angels, seven candlesticks, seven thunders. You got sevens all through there. Seven in the Hebrew is the word Sheba. It means it's the cardinal number seven. And then the word oath, one of the common words for oath, comes from the word Sheba, and it is the word Shebuah, Shebuah. It means to seven oneself by taking an oath to God. But you can't seven yourself until you add these things in 2 Peter 1 and verse 5. So as you add these things, a lot of people say, I want to be strong in the faith, and I want to be strong now. And I'm sorry, you can't be. Well, I want to grow up and I want to be a real powerful Christian. That's like saying, I'm 5 years old and I want to grow up to be 6'5" and be real big and strong, like big, tall men. Well, you can't do that when you're five. It's going to take you another 20 years. Just the same way it is in being a strong believer. You have to add these things. Virtue. Number one there in verse 5. Virtue, arete. Arete means manliness. You start off with little faith, and you have to grow up to be a man and to be mature. It takes a long time to be mature, doesn't it? You can't be mature overnight. You can't be a real strong Christian overnight. Well, yeah, but Jim, I don't want to go through this hard stuff. Neither did I. I didn't want to wait till I was 65 or 70 to be real strong as a believer. But I had to, and so do you. You'll be stronger if you're 25. You'll be stronger when you're 35. You may go off and sin. God may beat you up and make you a lot stronger. And then you'll be stronger at 45. You'll get pretty strong at 50, 55. And then you hit 65 or 70, you'll get real strong. And Paul said, the weaker I become in the flesh, the stronger I become spiritually. You got to get weak in the flesh and say, I can't do the things that I used to do. I can't have my way. I can't do the things that I want to do, that I used to want to do, and I want to do them anymore as you grow older and you rely upon the Lord instead of yourself. Add your faith, virtue, to virtue, knowledge. Here's the knowledge here. And I've got a library, and I have books that I suggest, and if anybody can get a set of McClintic and Strong Encyclopedia, that's a wonderful start. These are fantastic books. But how long does it take to add all this knowledge? 50 years, 60 years. And then he says, to knowledge, temperance. That's one of my favorite things you have to add. I really love this word, temperance. Temperance is a word that means self-control. When you are temperate, enkratia is the word, E-G-K-R-E-T-E-I-A. Enkratia. Now, when you add these things, this has to do with the last will and testament. That's what it has to do with. Because when you have self-control, it actually comes from E-N. It means within. And K-R-E-T-E-U-O, kretuo. Or kretos, K-R-E-T-O-S, kretos, or kretos. There's various ways to spell. These are all forms of the same word. And this means strength within. How long does it take you to keep your strength within where you're not going out here trying to control other people? We cannot change other people. When we lose our temper and we want to knock somebody in the head because they did us wrong, you don't have temperance. What we have to do is lose our temper, get in a screaming fight about 500,000 times for about 40 years, and you wake up one day and you say, I'm not getting anywhere with this. I think I'll try something different. That's when self-control comes on our lives. It takes years of fire, trials, persecution, tribulation. And when you go through so much of this, you get to a place one day and you get tired of yourself, losing your temper, trying to have your way, and you wake up to the fact that you have an inheritance. Now, how do you get out of all of this, this losing your temper and not being mature, immaturity, and how do you get out of us? We have been given an inheritance. The Bible says our inheritance is to drink the cup. Drinking of a cup meant to undergo a death. Undergo death. And when you drink the cup, you quit worrying about today, what's going on. Yeah, but Jim, you just don't know what I've been through. Yes, I do. I've been through as much as anybody here. I've nearly died several times. Under such stress, put myself in the hospital. Ended up, thought I was dying of pneumonia one time. Thought I was dying of bronchial pneumonia at another time. In and out of the hospital constantly, stressing myself out. And I came to the realization, inner strength is when I realize that God is in charge. Predestination's true. We are predestined to an inheritance. We're predestined to drink the cup. We have obtained an inheritance being predestinated. According to the purpose of Him who works all things, all this fire in our life, to cause us to grow up and be manly, to cause us to have knowledge. You know what it takes to get knowledge? I'm going to tell you. When I was young, I was really had a desire for the Lord, and I wanted to learn the truth. And my mother and father gave me a Bible when I was in high school, and I tried to read it. I don't understand this. I tried to read some more. I don't understand this. What in the world is this talking about? And I don't understand anything. And I kept trying to read, and I put the Bible down, and I'd pick it back up, and I'd read and read and read, and sometimes I'd read, didn't understand anything I was reading. Has anybody ever done that besides me? And I'd read some more, and I'd read and read, and I was a reader, but I wasn't even understanding what I was reading. So I'd read some more. And the more I'd read, every once in a while I'd run across something, and I'd say, oh, wait a minute, I saw that back here. And I think I saw it back over here. And I begin to put things together one piece at a time. And then the longer I lived and the more I would force myself to read, and I go through ups and downs and ups and downs. I go through periods of time I don't feel like reading. Do you ever have that problem? I do that now. But so does everybody else. Don't think that you're especially bad sinner because you don't feel like reading. You know, I don't feel like watching the DVDs. Well, nobody does unless they're going through that up time. And they go back down, they go back up, and they go back down. That's everybody. This is a long, hard process. What really made me study harder was obligating myself to teaching. And the more I would teach, and I'm not talking about go out here and start you a church. I'm talking about get around people, witness to people, talk to them, try to explain things in the Bible to them. If they want it, if they don't, leave them alone. Let's read that again. Besides all this, give all diligence, add to your faith. If you don't add to your faith, what happens? Faith is death to self, isn't it? If you don't have more death to self, but you're not going to have a lot of death to self when you first start, you're going to have little faith. Oligos pistis, O-L-I-G-O-S, P-I-S-T-I-S. Oligos means puny. Pistis means faith. I'm sorry, but the apostles had little faith, but they learned to die literally. Took a lot of years. You can't get this overnight. I keep saying, you want to be a fantastic, great concert pianist? Get your piano and start practicing. Get you a teacher and practice 6 hours a day, every day for 25 years, okay? You're not going to be a concert pianist in 6 months or a year or 2 years or 3 years or 5 years, are you? And you might be a concert pianist in 25 or 30 years. No one is going to grow fast. But if you don't grow, what happens? Well, it'll tell you right here what happens. If you don't grow, here's what happens to you. Jim, that's too painful to read when I don't feel like reading. Tell me about it. I know it's hard to read when you don't feel like reading, and now you came in from a job. I used to come in from a job and force myself to read the Bible, and after 15 minutes, I'd say, I can't understand this. But I had some kind of perseverance in me. I'd come back and make myself be bored again until it began to come together. When you first start doing anything, the hardest thing to do is run your scales when you first start, isn't it? It's not so hard when you can make pretty chords later on. When you can start constructing something. I've told the story. I used to lift weights when I was young. I was a pretty strong young guy. I wanted to be a power lifter, and I weighed 165 pounds, and I was bench pressing over 300 pounds. That wasn't hard. What was hard? The hardest thing in weightlifting I ever did, I don't look like it, but I was, the hardest thing I ever did was go to Jimmy Gatewood's house at 16 years old, and they were lifting weights. I'd never done it before, and I had arms that big around. And they said, come on over here, and you see if you can what you can do. I said, oh, I don't want to do that. I want to be cool. Finally, they got me on the bench, and they put 70 pounds on me. And this is what happened. Whoa, whoa, oh, get it off of me. That was hard. It wasn't hard to, man, I used to pump 250 about 20 times. Foo, foo, foo. But the hardest thing is starting. The hardest thing to do in learning your Bible and getting knowledge is starting. You got to get some kind of foundation. You got to get a little strength. But you have to force yourself and make yourself do it. You have to bring your body into subjection, Paul said there in the 9th chapter of 1 Corinthians. He said, if I do not bring my body into subjection, the word is D-O-U, doulagogeo. I had a guy ask me one time, he said, I've had doulagogeo running through my mind all night long. What is that? I said, bring your body in subjection. It means to enslave yourself to God. What is a slave? That's somebody who's working because he wants to and because he likes it. Not when you start. It's real hard. You want to grow up fast? Forget it. I'm not going to be like these preachers that will tell you, oh, you can be wonderful to be wonderful with God, and we'll just praise God and we'll go to the high heavens. Not weak you won't. And he goes on to say, if you add to your faith virtue to virtue knowledge, I have read and studied the 70 weeks of Daniel. I started studying the 70 weeks of Daniel in 1964. That's why it takes me a year to go through it. Because I have to go through all the Bible and all these characters, all through 1 and 2 Samuel, Kings, and Chronicles. I got to go through Daniel. I go into Revelation. You can't teach the 70 weeks of Daniel by studying it with me for 2 years. And to knowledge, self-control. When you're losing your temper, you're trying to control others' actions toward you. And you can't ever do that. Never. What you can do, here's what you can do. You can learn to accept the fact that God has ordained everything the way it is. He's declared the end from the beginning. And from ancient times, everything that's not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand and I'll do all my pleasure. Let me quote it this way. He's declared the end from the beginning, from ancient times, everything that people haven't done to you yet. Did you get that? All the misdeeds and all of the cheating and lying that somebody's going to do to you, he has done that and declared it from the beginning, and he's saying, I want you to learn to rest in the fact that I'm doing it, and I want you to grow up and mature and accept it. You know when you start accepting what people do to you, they don't do it as much. You don't have as many problems. Because they look at you and they know there's something strange about you and he must be mature. I can't run him down. I can't run over him. You have to get a control. That Temperance means get control of yourself. Quit trying to control other people. When you try to control other people with your temper, with your rage, with your voice, with your yelling, with your screaming, with your losing it, you don't have any self-control. You're trying to control others. And then if we add temperance to temperance, patience. Patience is the exact opposite of losing it, isn't it? Patience, hupomone. Where are you going to get that? I want to be patient. God, give me patience. Give it to me right now. That's what most people want. Right now. Well, the trying of your faith, when you try faith, the trying of your faith worketh patience. And don't pray that the fire will go away. Let patience have its perfect work. Say, Lord, teach me to go through this, through the fire. That's what I need, Lord. Help me. And the trying of your faith is more precious than gold that perisheth, though the gold be tried by fire. Gold will perish, but our faith will never perish. And faith is death to self, and faith has to grow. Then he says, and how does all this come about? This is what we have been given to inherit it. It is drinking the cup. Drinking the cup is death to self. If you have death to self, you're going to grow up and be mature. You're going to have virtue. If you have death to self, you're going to grow up and force yourself to read your Bible even when you don't want to and you don't feel like it. Now I'm not here to say that you're going to go home tonight and make yourself read all night and make yourself read tomorrow night. Do I think you're going to conquer this easy? No, you're not going to. Everybody has the same problem. Billy Graham has a hard time finding a place to read his Bible. First of all, he don't know anything about the truth. All preachers have a hard time. Do you know most of them are spending their time administrating and not studying, and they go down here to Lifeway and they buy them a little book of sermons so they'll have their sermons and they don't even study. Most of them don't study at all. And to knowledge, temperance, and to temperance, patience, going through the fire and the trials, and to patience, godliness. When you get into godliness, Mr. Strong tell you me, it means the gospel or the gospel arrangement or scheme of things. The gospel is the resurrection. And resurrection, it means to come to life after dying, anastasis. That means to come to life after dying. Well, we die daily. How do you die daily? Do you start off with a little faith, dying daily? No. You have a hard time. You grow a little. I tell people, learn a couple of Greek words and use them. Just use them on somebody out in public. Tell them what prayer means or what love means. And we do this, me and Mary do this all the time out in public. But I don't force it on anybody. I don't try to make them believe. If they don't want to hear it, I don't bother them with it. You've got a whole world out there to experiment on. Did you know that? But don't beat anybody up with it. Just try to talk to them about the Bible. And the more you learn, the more you want to do it. Yeah, we talked to a couple last night for a long time. And sometimes it just turns out to be a wonderful time. This growing is not something that's going to happen, but our testament, our last will and testament is to drink the cup. Jesus took the cup at the Last Supper and said, Last Supper, it was the last Passover. He said, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. Testament, diatheke, means a last will and testament. Jesus had to die in order for us to drink the cup. Drinking the cup wasn't grape juice. They were made been drinking it that night, drinking of the Passover, but that was a contract. To drink the cup was death. And he said, when I die about 18 hours from now, I want all of my people to learn to drink the cup. You don't drink it all at once. You try. You start off, somebody makes fun of you, laughs at you because you're a Christian and you're not strong enough and don't know enough about the Bible. So you get ashamed, go off and hide until you get the guts enough to come out from your hiding place. Anybody had a hard time besides me? I used to have really have a hard time. I pushed myself and pushed when I was young. I get in situations, I'd back away, what's wrong with me? I'm such a dumb kid. I don't know nothing. I felt the same thing that you feel. You say, but Jim, you're strong now. Well, now, but gosh, I'm 76. Why shouldn't I be? I've been studying for nearly 60 years. I should be strong. If you lift weights for 25 years, you can go up there and compete in some big contest. It doesn't matter what it is. I don't care if it's playing piano, if it's mathematics. You want to be good at something, you're going to have to start slow, go easy, and be around the people of God. You got to be around people that are strong. They lift each other up. We hold you up. We hold each other up, don't we? There's an old saying, no man is an island. You're not an island. You can't do it alone. You need the fellowship of his suffering, don't you? The fellowship of his suffering. You know what, when Paul said there in the third chapter of Philippians, that I may know him, and the power of his resurrection, and the fellowship of his suffering. What fellowship of his suffering, that sounds like some theological term. It's actually fellowshipping with people who are suffering too. I had a fellow call me yesterday. He said, oh man, he lives up in Gallatin. He's been listening to us. He come down once. He said, I'm going to lose everything with this message. I'm losing everything. I'm going to lose my wife. I'm going to lose my family, my house, my everything. I'm losing it, Jim. You don't know what this is like. I said, yes, I do. But you just don't understand. I said, yes, I understand exactly. I said, you need the fellowship. Come here with these people, and they'll tell you how they're losing their families too because of this truth. And their friends. No one is unique in this. Nobody. We all have all these things in common. Every one of the elect have something in common. The Bible says, when you're in truth, a man's foes will be those of his own household. Father will turn against... Look over here in Luke, the 12th chapter. Look at this. Look in Luke 12. Luke, the 12th chapter. This is a part of our inheritance. Luke 12. Was it Luke 12? No. Yeah, Luke 12. Luke 12, verse 49. I am come to send fire on earth, and what will I if it be already kindled? The fire is the word of God. Remember, is not my word of fire? In Israel is wood, and my word will consume them. But I have a baptism to be baptized with. I've got to undergo a fire. And how am I straightened? Suneco is the word straighten, S-U-N-E-C-H-O. How am I held together? And you're going to say, Jim, this is so hard, like this fellow that called me, and I love this guy. He's struggling so hard. And you're saying, but how am I going to be held together? I'm losing everything. My family hates me, and my wife, my husband hates me, and nobody loves me, and they're giving me a hard time, and I'm going to lose my temper. And well, you can't, because God holds us together till this be accomplished. It is a baptism of fire. And look what he says. Suppose ye that I am come to give peace on earth, I tell you, no, but rather division. When you tell people that Christmas is pagan and Easter is pagan and God does not love everybody, here's what's going to happen. But rather division. For from henceforth there shall be five in one house, divided three against two, two against three. The father shall divide it against the son against the father against the daughter against the mother-in-law against her daughter-in-law, the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. Look at Matthew 10. Look at that. Look at Matthew's account of this. You want an easy way. There is no such thing as wanting to believe in Christmas that it's paganism, it's Roman Catholicism, and telling people that all these things are true. God doesn't love everybody. Predestination is true. God creates evil. And you want to do that peacefully? That's why this is called suffering. Unto you it is given in the behalf of Christ not only to believe upon him, but also to suffer for his sake. It hurts. It's supposed to. You want an easy way? There ain't one. And you have a requirement. You have to go through this. Well, I want an easier way. I know what you want, but you can't have it. I can't have it. Why is God going to let you have an easy way when he hadn't let me have one? He didn't let Jesus have one. He didn't let Paul have one. They took Paul to Rome and cut his head off. They crucified Peter upside down. They crucified Andrew on a St. Andrew's cross. They beat out Timothy's brains with a bastinado, and we're supposed to have it easy? There's no easy way to be a believer. It's a requirement. It has been left to us as our inheritance. Look here in Matthew 10. Here's the way Matthew puts it. Jesus is sending out the apostles to preach the word. Look at verse 16. Behold, I send you forth as sheep in the midst of wolves. Be ye therefore wise as serpents and harmless as doves. Harmless is the word akarios. A-K-A-I-R-O-S. O-U-S. Akarios means to have an unmixed feeling. You know that doves are completely passive animals. We've had doves in our house one time. I thought they were so cute until they coo, coo all day long. And it drives you crazy. Doves have no evil nature whatsoever. You can reach in, pick them up. They'll just coo at you. We're to have that kind of a nature. That's the nature that Jesus had. You've heard me talk about mixed religion. You're not to mix the paganism of the world with Christ. We're to have the gentleness of a dove without having anger and fury and rage in us. How long does it take you to get that way? Long time. Now, look what Jesus says. I send you as beware of men, for they will deliver you up to councils. They will scourge you in their synagogues. You shall be brought before governors and kings for my sake, for a testimony against them and the Gentiles. But when they deliver you up, take no thought how or what you will speak, for it shall be given you in the same hour that ye shall speak. But how's it going to be given us? Some miracle thing? No. We're going to read and study this word. And the only reason we're going to be brought before magistrates is because of what we're saying. And the Spirit will tell us what to say, but he won't come down and say, tell this to them. You will say the word of God to them gently, kindly, firmly. And you won't compromise. For it is not ye that speak, but the Spirit of your Father which speaketh in you. And the brother shall deliver up brother to death. I didn't get along with my little brother. He's very devious and underhanded. My older brother, just neither here nor there. I tried to talk to Clyde one time, and I said, Clyde, let me talk to you about predestination. Jimmy, I ain't got time for that. And then he died. And the brother shall deliver up the brother to death, the father the child, and the children shall rise up against their parents and cause them to be put to death. Now, that's not surprising when that happens in this world. The Bible says it's going to happen. Ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but he that endureth to the end shall be saved. You mean he that holds out? No. He that may know, or hupo may know, he that continues to the end. Who's going to continue to the end? Well, the Bible says, he that hath begun a good work in you in Philippians 1:6 will perform it all the way till the day of Jesus Christ to the end. He began the work in his people and he'll perform it. You'll go through fire, trials, persecution, tribulation. You'll get depressed. You'll get discouraged. You'll get down. You'll say, when am I going to get up? When am I going to be strong? When you get old and it won't matter anymore. when you get real old and you're tired. You're tired of yourself. You're tired of the world. It don't bother what people do to you then. You don't care. That's when you're strong. Look here what he says. And when they persecute you in the city, flee ye unto another. For verily I say unto you that ye shall not have gone over the cities of Israel till the Son of Man be come. The disciple is not above his master. You're not better than me. And Jesus said the same thing in John 15. You're not better than me. If I suffered, you have to go through the same thing. For some reason, people want to call me and say, Jim, give me an easy way out. I say, don't have any. We have to go through it, don't we? Nor the servant above his Lord. It is enough for the disciple that he be as his master. The servant is as his Lord. We are as Jesus. What did they do to him? Well, they lied about him, and they took him, and they killed him. Are you any better than him? If they have called the master of the house, Beelzebub, they said, Jesus cast out devils by Beelzebub. They called him, he's a Samaritan. And you want to be treated nicer than that? You will get stronger as the years go by. But you're in it for the duration. If God convicted your heart and wrote his word in fleshy tables of your heart, where you get strength is among other believers, isn't it? When we come together, that's where our strength is. That's where our joy is when we face the world. That's why Jesus sent the apostles out in twos. They gave each other strength. They went together, and one would say something, then the other would say something. I like to, if I go to the store, I like to have somebody with me that I can preach to. Me and Dave will be in a store. I say, Dave, when I go over here to the checkout counter, you go with me and I'll start preaching to you. I say, I know you already know this stuff, but I'm not preaching to you. I'm preaching to the guy behind the checkout counter. And I do that. That's a common habit of mine. Take some guy and I'll talk to Dave like he don't know nothing about what I'm talking about. He'll know everything I'm talking about, but I'm preaching to the guy checking us out. And they don't know what to do when you're not talking to them. How much more shall they call them of his household? Fear them not, therefore, for there is nothing covered that shall not be revealed, and hid that shall not be known. God will take the cover off before it's over with. What I tell you in darkness, that speak ye in the light. Go out in the public, tell it to the world. And what you hear in the ear, that preach ye upon the housetops, and fear not them which kill the body, and are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. Quit being afraid of the world. The world is not smart when it comes to the Bible. They don't know anything. You're always in charge of them if you know a little bit. You may not know that, but you are. Are not two sparrows sold for a farthing, and one of them shall not fall to the ground without your Father? If God knows the sparrows of the air, does he not know our lives? And the very hairs of your head are numbered. You got an exact number of hairs, and as they fall out, God says there's number 4,322. And everything is numbered, including the hairs on your head. Fear ye not, therefore, ye are ye not more value than sparrows? Do you think God's not going to take care of us? In Matthew, the 6th chapter, Jesus said, take no thought for your life, what you'll eat or drink, how you'll be clothed. The Heavenly Father knoweth that you have need of all these things. He knows what you have need of before you ask. Yeah, but my life is miserable. I'm having a hard time. He knows that too. So was his. Whosoever therefore shall confess me before men, him will I confess. Homologeo, I'll agree with. He's saying, you're going to be hated when you go out and confess Christ. Confessing is not a one-time thing down here at an altar. Homologeo, you do that daily. That's what's going to cause brother to turn against brother, sister against brother, father and mother against children. It's the truth. Everybody is not believers, only a few. Welcome to the world of Christianity. God has convicted your heart and my heart. He's written in our hearts, there's no way out. Everybody has a hard time with this, don't you? You don't have an easy way out. There's no such thing as an easy way through Christianity. Now, let's read on. I will confess before my Father which is in heaven, but whosoever shall deny me before men, him will I also deny before my Father which is in heaven. Think not that I am come to send peace on earth. I came not to send peace, but a sword. And God's sword is the word of God, isn't it? Over there in Hebrews, the 4th chapter, look at it quickly, and then I'll come back here. Here's what the word of God does to people when we speak to them. Hebrews, the 4th chapter. Verse 12. For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and the marrows, and as a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. It'll make your knees shake. It'll tear people apart. They don't like the truth of God when they don't have it written in their hearts, and it's our job to witness to them and tell them about what God says. And if they're not believers, and if they're not elect, they'll go to hell, and they'll hear your words through eternity, and it'll be the judgment of God. Go back over here to Matthew, the 10th chapter. He says in verse 34, let me read it again. Think not that I am come to send peace on earth. I came not to send peace, but a sword. For I am come to set a man at variance. The word is dikazo. D-I-C-H-A-Z-O. It means to sunder. You know, when something is asunder, it means it's split up. This means to split. It means to set apart against his father. And the daughter against her mother. And the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And a man's enemies, his foes, shall be those of his own household. You don't like it because your mother don't like your being in this truth, or your brother and sister, or your husband, or your wife. You're in for the ride. You will get over it. You will get stronger the longer you live in it. It's not going to happen one day. You say, Jim, you sure are trying to make things sound negative. Well, the word deny, when you look up the word negative in a Webster's dictionary right here, one of the definitions will say deny. Negative is to deny or gives an opposite meaning. We are to deny self. We're to be negative about ourselves. Positive. Now, you don't hear that from preachers. Then he says, he that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And he that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. I've got a daughter that's 55 years old. I hadn't seen her since she's 25. She wants nothing to do with anything I'm saying. I used to cry over her when she's young. I had all these tears. I have none for her anymore. She will die in her sin and be in hell if she don't repent. And that'll be between her and God, not between me and her. He that taketh not his cross and followeth after me is not worthy of me. And we have to take our cross daily, according to Luke 9:23 and Luke 14:27. If we don't take our cross, then we can't be a follower of Christ. You have to have a cross in order to be a follower of Christ.
Somebody said that was Jesus' cross, not our cross.
Well, that's dumb. That's not Jesus' cross. That's our own cross. He that findeth his life shall lose it. If you try to live this life, and I want a happy life, and I don't like this real hard time as a Christian, and you can find a happy way to live in this flesh, then you get to go to hell one day. What do you mean? I thought we were supposed to be joyous. I thought we were supposed to be joyful. The word joy is the word kara. That's the word joy. Rejoice. Rejoice. And kara comes from the word charis, which is the word grace. Are we to be gracious to people who don't believe God? No. If a person comes bringing any other doctrine there in 2 John 10, do not bid them Godspeed. Godspeed is the word kero. C-H-A-I-R-O, excuse me. Kero. Kero comes from the word charis, which is the word grace, which is comes from the word joy. Now, what does the Bible say who we're supposed to rejoice with? Look over here in 1 Corinthians, the 13th chapter. 1 Corinthians 13. I had somebody write to me and say, you're supposed to be joyful. Not to everybody, I'm not. If someone comes preaching another doctrine, do not bid them Godspeed, which is that word kero, which comes from the word kero, joy. Don't rejoice with somebody who brings another doctrine. Don't have joy with them. We're not talking about fun. When you look up the word fun, it's the word phoné, comes from the ancient word phoné. It means foolish. Joy, Paul says, he tells the Philippian church, in Philippians the 4th chapter, you are my joy. All of this that we're talking about, the misery that we have to go through, is our inheritance. It's death to self. I'm not sorry to tell you that this is what you have to go through. You say, I'm having such a hard time. I know that. Stay around the people of God. Be around the people that believe the truth. And I'll be honest with you, I don't know what to tell somebody out in California. He says, Jim, what am I going to do? I don't have anybody out here. I said, well, you can move here. I try to get classes together in the various cities, and it's hard to pull them together. Usually you'll have some guy come in, and I've decided to be the preacher here, and he'll start a fuss and start saying, we don't like what Jim Brown preaches, and then the class will split up, and they all go their ways. I don't have a miracle answer. All I can say is you got to be around the people of God. That fellowship of his suffering is what makes you strong. We're predestined to conform to the likeness of Christ. Through whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed. To be conformed, sumorphos, comes from morphe, meaning shaped. You're shaped into Christ's likeness by fellowship. Sum means to blend together. The word sum is a prefix on words that they put on words. It means to synthesize together, to blend together. You blend together in fellowship when you believe the same things, you believe the truth, you're dying daily, you're having troubles, the person next to you is having troubles. You get together at the picnic or the chili cookout and you talk to each other and you say, yeah, I'm going through this and that, and my ex-husband or my ex-wife, they used to beat me and they threatened to kill me, and my mother don't like this. She said I'm off in a cult and she says I'm crazy. And the other person says, me too, you know, I had a problem. And everybody says, I've gone off the deep end and I feel so wonderful here being around the believers of God. That's the fellowship that molds us into Christ's likeness. You have to have that. Look over here. Where did I say he was going? 13. Who are we to be fellowshipping with? Look here what the Bible says. I've been meaning to go through this. This is a list. A lot of people call this the love chapter. I hate to call it the love chapter. Let's call it the walking in God's commandments chapter, okay? People are silly when they go, this is the love chapter. Charity. Anywhere at time you find the word charity, it is the word agape. We've said this 5,000 times here, agape. You got two words that have been ambiguously. Ambiguous means it has no definite meaning. it has a dual meaning. You can't figure out what it means. Agape and phileo have both been translated into love. Agape has sometimes been translated into charity. Every time you find the word charity, it's agape. So whatever agape is, that is every time the word is translated from agape to love or agape to charity. We know that agape is walking after the commandments of God. Walking after commandments. This is love. This is agape. This is charity. That we walk after His commandments. 2 John 6. So wherever you find charity or agape, you can insert walking after the commandments. Now let's, if we're walking after the commandments of God, we're trying to be obedient to His word. Look here what the Bible says. Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, have not charity. Now that confuses people. Tongue is the word glossa. It means foreign languages. Though I'm speaking with the gloss of the foreign languages here in Corinth, where they have 100 or more dialects and gloss of foreign languages, and if I'm speaking in their language of an angel, angel, remember, is the word angelos, A-G-G-E-L-O-S. It's the word messenger. He's saying, though I am a messenger of God, and I'm speaking in this gift that God gave the early apostles, but it's not here today. That's so that people could hear in their own dialect where they were born. He said, and I'm not walking in God's commandments. I'm preaching the word of God as a messenger of God, and I'm not walking in the commandments of God. I'm a noisemaker. If I'm up here telling you all about predestination and Christmas is pagan, and you can go out there and find me in life cussing and drinking and gossiping about people and ripping people apart and all of this kind of stuff, if you can find me doing that, I am a worthless preacher. That's what he says. If you go out and you try to talk to people about truth and you have not charity, you're a sounding brass and tinkling cymbal. You're just making a noise. If you talk the talk, you got to walk the walk. Jim, I have a hard time. I understand that. But you got to be wrestling with it. You cannot just be rebelliously involved in what David called presumptuous sin. Zewd is the word presumptuous. Z-U-W-D or Z-E-D. There's various spellings of it. It means proud. Mr. Spurgeon said, presumptuous sin is standing right in the light and sinning against it, knowing what you're doing. And if anybody knew about presumptuous sin is planning your sin. I'm going to go to this club and pick up some girl, and I won't let anybody in Grace and Truth Ministries know that I'm doing that. I'm going to drink a little, but I'm not going to let Grace and Truth people know I'm doing it. We've had people come here that were supposed to be faithful here and just blurt out the F word. What? What are you doing? There's no commitment to Christ in that. I hate those words. Now, though I have the gift of prophecy, understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I can remove mountains, and I'm not walking in God's commandments, I'm nothing. There's a verse in Ephesians that goes along with this I really love. Look over there. In Ephesians, and then I'll come back to this. Ephesians. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians. Look here in Ephesians, the fourth chapter, Ephesians 4, and it's talking about the winds of doctrine that preachers are preaching. Verse 14, that we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men. The word sleight is the word cubia. It's our word cube, and it's talking about dice. They were called cubia or cubes, and it has the idea, like the scholars say, of switching dice and having loaded dice. By the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, wherein they lie in wait to deceive. People are sneaking up on people's blind side all the time to meet them out of money, get attention, or whatever it is they can get. He says, we're not to be doing this, but speaking the truth in love. Now, I've had people say, you're supposed to speak the truth in love and love everybody when you talk it to them. You're supposed to be phileo and be nice to them. That's not this word. When you speak the truth, you're to speak it in agape, walking in the commandments of God. You should always be walking in the... If you're not going to walk in the commandments, don't talk to anybody. I used to have a guy, I've told the story before. He'd call me. He'd see me on the TV. He came here once or twice. And he was somebody that came from Virginia. He wanted to be a music star. And he came to Nashville to become famous. And they've got 20 dozen bars down there off Broadway and down there off Music Row. And he'd call me from a bar. He'd say, Jim, I'm down here at this bar, and I'm telling these people about predestination. I said, don't you tell them that you come to church up here. You get out of there, and don't you mention our name. He's going to talk to them about predestination down there while he's drunk. I said, don't you mention my name or Grace and Truth. We're not supposed to be doing that, are we? We speak the truth while we're walking in the commandments of God. And if we don't do that, we're just making a noise, because he goes on to say, when you speak the truth while you're walking in God's commandments, you may grow up unto him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. And what will happen, you'll be fitly joined together. Sunarmalagaomai. The word fitly joined. Soon. Sunarmalogaomai. It comes from soon. That means to blend together, to mesh together in fellowship. Fellowship. Soon is a word. It's a prefix that you put on the front of a word instead of putting K-O-I-N-O-N-I-A. Koinonia is the word fellowship. It's the word communion. It is the word partaker. And then harmos, it comes from harmos and logos. What this word means, it means in fellowship, we speak the word of God distinctly. That's how you grow in the truth. And he says, fitly joined, sunarmalagaomai, means to be blended together in the truth of God's exact word. That's what it's talking about. So that's how you grow, and you don't do that by being nice to everybody and liking them. Speak the truth and like them while you're talking to them. That's not what it's talking about. Fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplieth, according to the effectual working in the measure of the body unto the edifying of itself. The body is the church. Edify. O-I-K-O-D-O-M-E-O. That's the word edify. It means to build up. It comes from oikos, which is the word house or family. And the word D-O-M-E, it looks like dome, and it is dome. It's pronounced dome in the Greek, and it means roof. And they said when they finished the roof, they had built the house of God. Well, the house will be, when we speak the truth of the word of God distinctly, defining the words, That's what caused the church to grow, not compromising and being sweet and gushy to people. Say the truth. Be gentle and kind as you can, but be firm. And then he goes on to say that in every measure and every part maketh increase in the body unto edifying of itself in agape. And then he says, if you don't do this, it's kind of like if you don't add to your faith over there in 2 Peter, something happens. Something happens in 2 Peter. It happens here. He says, here's what happened if you don't do it. This I say therefore and testify in the Lord that ye henceforth walk not as other Gentiles walk in the vanity of their minds. He's talking to the church. Mataiotes, M-A-T-A-I-O-T-E-S. Profitlessness. If you don't walk in that fitly joined together, that's speaking of a body. Everything has it. Every joint is exactly where it's supposed to be. It has smoothness in the movement of the body. There's no schisms there. People are not arguing and fussing and fighting. And he goes on to say that you don't walk as the Gentiles walk in the vanity of their mind. When you do that and you don't walk in this exact word of God, your understanding is darkened. He's not talking to unbelievers here. The church will get to where their understanding is dark. They're being alienated from the life of God through ignorance. If you're ignorant, you don't know and you're not adding knowledge. What happens if you don't grow and you don't take your cross and die? You have a little faith to start with, you just stay a baby all along for years. That's why I define the words. I want people to mature and grow up. Look back at 2 Peter real quick. Back at 2 Peter. In 2 Peter, Peter's talking here, and he says, add to your faith. And here's what he says will happen if you add to your faith. And the exact opposite will happen if you don't add to your faith. If your faith doesn't grow, he'll tell you what will happen either way. You add godliness in verse 7. And brotherly kindness in verse 7. But brotherly kindness is not added unless people are walking right or walking in agape. Brotherly kindness is the word philos, adelphos. This is the word brotherly kindness. We get our word Philadelphia from this. And they call Philadelphia the city of brotherly love. That's because that's the Greek meaning of the word philos. A-D-E-L-P-H-O-S. Adelphos is the word brother. Philos means to have affection for. But here's the whole point. Who is our brothers? The ones who do the will. My brothers and sisters are those who do the will of the Father. If they're doing the will of the Father, they're walking in agape. God is saying if they're not walking in agape, don't you have an affection for them? Leave them alone and get away from them. Withdraw from every brother who walks disorderly. Not after these commandments which you receive from us, Paul says there in 2 Thessalonians, the third chapter. But look at the rest of this in 2 Peter. Look at verse 8. For if these things be in you and abound, if you have a superabundance of arete, virtue, knowledge, temperance, patience, godliness. You're going through all kinds of fiery trials. You've studied for years. Brotherly kindness and charity. If these things be in you and abound, they will make you that you shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. You'll be having the fruit of the Spirit there in Galatians 5:22. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, meekness, goodness, faith. You'll have these in you. But if you don't add these things, look what happens to you. But he that lacketh these things is blind. He's not talking about the vessels of wrath that lack these things are blind. That's not what he's talking about. He's saying the believer that lack these things is blind, and he cannot see very good. He can't see afar off. His vision is very limited spiritually. And hath forgotten. Now notice that word forgotten. This is a person that is a believer, but he's forgotten that he was purged from his old sins. He hasn't grown. He's loafed around. He hasn't read his Bible. He hasn't gone through the fire. All he's done is complained, and you're not getting anywhere. He's forgotten that he was purged from his old sin. If a person forgets that he has been somewhere, then he's been there, hadn't he? Right? I said, well, I don't know. Did I go to Denver that time? I don't know. I don't remember. That don't mean I didn't go. I just forgot. A person that doesn't add these things is very unsure, very unstable. Jim, I want to add these things. Can I do that next week? I'm sorry, but you can't. It takes time. It takes time to grow. I know that you don't want to take that time to grow, but you have to. Well, is it going to be fun? No, a lot of it's going to be miserable. You're going to be suffering. You're going to be hurt. You're going to be persecuted. People are going to be laughing, make fun of you. They used to do that to me when I was younger. They do it now, but it don't bother me now. It don't bother me. It doesn't bother me to face anyone with the Bible because most people don't know nothing about it. I'll face any preacher in the country because they don't know what this is about. They pretend to. And then he says, wherefore, the rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure by adding these seven things. If you add these seven things, you'll never fall. For if you do these things, you will never fall. But how long is it going to take to add virtue, knowledge, controlling your temper and your mind? Your temper doesn't start with your mouth. It starts up here. You got to come to the place where your mind says, this is the will of God. Are you going to get there next week? Probably not. Are you going to get there next month? No. You'll grow very, very slow as you get stronger. And this is the cup. When Jesus said, this cup is the New Testament, and he said, drink ye all of it. He is saying, go through the fire, go through all the fire and drink the cup every day of your life, and you'll drink a little bit of it back here. And it'll grow and grow, and you'll get to where you can swallow a whole lot of the fire. You have to learn to embrace the fire. I'm sorry there's not an easy way to be a Christian, but there's not. It's not this mushy gospel they preach up the street, is it? Not at all. You want to be strong in the faith? You got to get weak. You got to get weak in the flesh, don't you? We got to be weak in order to be strong. Look over there in 2 Corinthians, the 12th chapter. Look at this. Well, I didn't finish 1 Corinthians, the 13th chapter. 2 Corinthians, the 12th chapter. Then I'll go to 1 Corinthians, the 13th chapter. How much time do I have, Mike? 24. All right, look here. In 2 Corinthians, what did I say was going? 12. 12. Yeah, 12. I got too many things on my mind. Now, Paul here says, verse 6, for though I would desire to glory, I shall not be a fool. I will say the truth, but now I forbear. I put up with a lot of things. lest any man should think of me above that which he seeth me to be, or that he heareth me. I don't want somebody to lift me up above what I am. And lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations. Paul said, I have written at least 13 books of the New Testament. I have had Christ reveal himself to me in person in that ninth chapter of Acts. Paul is one of God's favorite men from the front of the Bible to the end, and he was a Christian killer. He said, unless men should lift me up above measure through these abundance of revelation, there was given to me a thorn in my fleshly body. Some believe that it was his eyes, because the fourth chapter of Galatians, Paul says to the Galatians, you did not despise this affliction that's in me when I was there. You would have plucked out your own eyes and given them to me. Some, look at that real quick. Look at that. Galatians. Now I'll get back to this. Galatians. This is why it's believed this was probably his affliction. Galatians 4, in verse 12. Brethren, I beseech you, be as I am, for I am as ye are. Ye have not injured me at all. You know how that through infirmity of the flesh I preached the gospel unto you at first. I had a sickness in my flesh. And my temptation is the word parosmos. Parosmos is that same word over there in 1 Peter 4 and 12. Think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you. It's the same thing as going through a trial. So here's what Paul says. You know that how through infirmity of the flesh I preached the gospel to you, and my temptation, my affliction, the thing I was going through, which was in my flesh, you didn't despise nor rejected, but received me as an angel of God, a messenger of God, even as Christ Jesus. Where is then the blessedness you spake of? For I bear you record that if it had been possible, you would have plucked out your own eyes and given them to me. Paul said at one point he had to write in large letters. It's believed his thorn in the flesh was his vision, and Luke was his stenographer, his secretary, and had to write his letters for him. Am I therefore become your enemy because I tell you the truth? Boy, that sounds like Jesus in John the 8th chapter. He said, you seek to kill me to the Pharisees because I tell you the truth. Now go back over here to 2 Corinthians 12. He says, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me, to beat me with this affliction, lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart from me. Does that sound committed to Christ? No. Paul knows that he knows we have need of before we ask. And we don't ask God to do things that he's laid down in our life. We don't ask him to take away an affliction. We bow to that, don't we? Paul says, I asked the Lord, would you take my affliction away? God says, no. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient to take you through all affliction you have. And Paul was running all over the Mediterranean area, being chased by Pharisees, trying to kill him. They let him down in a basket over a wall. They tried to stone him and kill him at Lystra. They were after him. They grabbed him at the end of his life. The Jews did. They were going to kill him. And the Romans took him away from him. They sent him to Rome. Most gladly, therefore, will I glory in my infirmities when I'm sick, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, sicknesses, reproaches. Reproach means infamy. I take pleasure in the fact that I'm hated by the world. If you're not hated by the world, the more you're hated by the world, the closer you are to God. Jesus said, if the world hated me, it'll hate you. Paul says, the world is reproaching me. They hate me. They're chasing me, trying to kill me. You think your life is hard? Follow this man. In reproaches, in necessities. I mean, Paul had all these necessities. Well, if you go to the 1 Corinthians 11 chapter, well, I don't have time to go there. In persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake, for when I am weak, then am I strong. I am become a fool in glorying. Ye have compelled me, for I ought to have be commended of you. For in nothing am I behind the very chiefest of apostles, though I be nothing. I'm not behind any of the apostles, even though I'm zero. Truly the signs of an apostle were wrought among you in all patience and signs and wonders and mighty deeds. For what is it wherein ye were inferior in the churches, except it be that I myself was not burdensome to you? Forgive me this wrong. Behold, the third time come unto you. I will not be burdensome to you, for I seek not yours, but you. For the children ought not to lay up for the parents, but the parents for the children. And then he says, I will very gladly spend and be spent for you, though the more abundantly I agape you and I walk in God's commandments concerning you, the less you love me. You think he was having a hard time? We've been given an inheritance, and that is to grow in faith. And if we don't grow, we're going to stumble and fall, and we will fail along the way. We have to grow. This is not a very encouraging message. The only encouragement is that God has written it in your heart, and you're one of His, and if you have to go through this, you get to go be with Him one day. If you don't go through this, you don't get to go be with Him. And you're not one of the elect. We're elected to obey God. When we obey God, the world hates us. We tell them to tell the world the truth about what the Bible says. He says, the less I will be loved. Look back over here in 1 Corinthians 12. I got to finish this. 13. And he says, we were talking about who do we rejoice with? You don't rejoice with everybody in the world. Look here in verse 4. He's going to tell you what charity does, or what walking in God's commandments. Every time he says it does something here, he says charity suffereth long. Suffereth long, macrothumia, means to put up with a lot of stuff before you lose it. Charity envieth not. It doesn't say, I want what they have, I want their position, I want to be the preacher, I want their car, I want their house. I want to grow fast. Charity vaunteth not itself, it doesn't lift itself up. Is not puffed up. Fuziao, it means to be big-headed. Charity didn't do that. You know, people that are conceited don't realize they're conceited. Most people don't. Does not behave itself unseemly, seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil, rejoiceth not with iniquity. That's where we started earlier. Rejoices is the word kara. It means to have joy with evil people. We said earlier, not supposed to like everybody. You're not to rejoice with them. Are you to mistreat people out in public? No. You're not to mistreat anybody. You have to keep at a distance from people that are not walking righteously, those that are walking disorderly. We're not doing that because we think we're better. Paul said, if we withdraw from them and they are a brother, they'll become ashamed and they'll start repenting. Now, we have an inheritance, and that is to drink the cup. And when we do, the cup that we drink, our brothers, our sisters, our mother, our father, our friends, our family, our wife, our husband will hand us the cup and say, drink this. We have to drink the cup. That is our inheritance. You have to get strong. When you get strong, You're drinking, you're still drinking the cup, but it gets to where it doesn't taste so bad. I've gotten to a point older. I'm very weary. I don't even know sometimes how to describe how I feel. I don't feel good most of the time because the world hates what I'm saying. They don't want to hear me say, God creates evil, God created sin, Christmas is pagan, Easter is pagan. If you do it, I can't fellowship with you in that. I can't fellowship with anybody. I'm to withdraw from people who walk disorderly. If a man's living wrong, I'm to withdraw from it. Jim, are you always walking around just sour? No, I treat everybody as gentle and kind as I can. Everywhere I go, every day.
Play with me.
Mary says, I play with her. We have a happy, quiet life, and people have accused us of being devious and underhanded and occult, and they're nasty. And come and live with us and watch us. We'll bore you to death. What are you going to eat, Mary? I don't know. Where do you want to eat? You want to go over here to Cracker Barrel? Well, if you want to, okay. Do we need to stop by the store? Yeah, let's stop and pick up the cleaning. Okay. You probably wouldn't want to live with us. It's not like we're having this exciting life or we're real devious and underheaded. We're going to get the world. And people think that's what we do when we say, you know what I've discovered? I've discovered that if you have a lot of information, I put out a lot of information in a message. Everybody knows that. You have a lot of information. Only Jehovah's Witnesses and some occult does that. If you have to be real shallow to be a good Baptist or a Church of Christ or a Pentecostal. You got to have not much information at all. That's the only thing that's spiritual. A lot of information, if you're a doctor of history, you have to be evil. If you're a doctor of theology, well, most of those are evil, and I don't consider them doctors. You need to live a quiet... What did Paul tell Timothy? Look over here in 1 Timothy. Look here. Look at 1 Timothy. I know this is... Huh? It's what? Well, I don't know if it's making noise or not. How am I going to know? All right. What am I going to do about it? How much time do I have?
11.
If it makes any more noise and he's back there in the back room hearing the noise and I'm up here and I don't hear any noise, I don't have any idea what you're talking about, Mike. Said, if it makes any more noise, I got a microphone over there. I don't hear it making any noise. All right. 1 Timothy. Here's how you're supposed to live. I exhort, therefore, that first of all, supplications, prayers, and intercessions, giving thanks, be made for all men. Now we're back to the all men. All men means red, yellow, white, black, and brown men, because God's going to pour out of his spirit on all flesh rather than the one flesh of the Jews over here. And Timothy's pastoring the church at Ephesus, and that's a Gentile church. So when he says all men, he's not talking about for all men in the world. And then he says, for kings. You mean we're to be praying for the president? No. The word king is the word basileus, B-A-S-I-L-E-U-S. It means a foundation, whoever is in charge of the church. It's been translated kings. It means a sovereign, whoever is in power. It don't mean, Lord, we pray that you'll save these butchers and barbarians overseas that are slaughtering the Al-Qaeda people. We pray that you'll save them. That's not what it's talking about. It's talking about the men in the church and all that are in authority, prominence. Lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty, for this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior. Be quiet, be gentle, Be tender. Be firm. I'm firm with the truth. If somebody asks me, do you believe this? And I don't believe it. I say, no, I don't believe that. Do you want me to tell you why? No, I don't want to hear it. Okay, I won't tell you. I leave them alone. But I don't beat around the bush and say, well, you know, some people believe that, but the way I kind of look at it, I don't talk like that to people. If I don't believe something, I say no. I don't have time to beat around the bush and circumvent a situation. Whatever circumvent means, it means beat around the bush is what it means. Now, I've got so much more on this inheritance. Our inheritance is to suffer. You know, Paul says that over and over. He says we have to suffer for righteousness' sake. Look over here in 2 Timothy 3. If you read Paul's life, you start in the 13th chapter of Acts, read all the way to the end of the book. That's everything about Paul and all the journeys he's going on. Watch all the people that are trying to kill him. He doesn't have a lot of money. He's not traveling in elegant style. He's not traveling on a jet or in a nice fancy car on a sleek highway. He's walking. He's riding mules. He's climbing over walls. He's hiding from the Pharisees. He's hiding from the world because he has a work to do. When it comes time to be killed, at the end of his life, he will make an appeal to Caesar, and they will send him to Rome, and he'll wait in a house there to be beheaded. Tradition says that he was beheaded. If I can find. Even when Jesus was being pursued by the Pharisees, if it wasn't his time, he'd say, my time has not yet come, and he would slip through the crowd. There's a time to die, literally. And Paul knew it wasn't his time. He went on his first missionary journey. Here's Israel right here, right down here. Here's Cyprus. He went up here to what we call Lebanon and got on a boat, went over to Cyprus, came up here and hit the coast of Perga and went up to Antioch, Iconium, Derbe, and Lystra. And that was through, this was in Acts, the 13th and 14th chapters. Then he came back home. And then when he came back home, Barnabas says, I'm ready to go again. But Paul said, okay, let's go. And Barnabas said, I'll go get John Mark. But John Mark quit on him as soon as they hit the coast of what we call Turkey here, right down that Perga, Pamphylia. And Paul said, I don't want him going with me. And Paul and Barnabas split up, and Paul went off by himself and picked up Timothy when he got up here to Lystra. Timothy was living in Lystra. Then he took off and gone on his next journey. And these journeys could last for several years. And then he went on his third journey, went back up here. If you notice, this is Turkey. This is Greece over here. All of Paul's journeys had to do with Turkey and Greece, except for his last one. You realize how much history is in Turkey? The seven churches of Asia were there. Was in Western, well, that's what they called Asia Minor. You had Lydia, you had Miletus, Ephesus, Troas, Pergamos. You had all these Troases right here, all these churches over here, and then Galatia was right there in the center of what we call Turkey. This is right below the Black Sea. Black Sea is also called the Euxine Sea, E-U-X-I-N-E. And Paul was going on these journeys. And then when he came back home around the 23rd chapter of Acts, he was taken by the Jews. They were about to kill him. And the Romans came in and took him away from the Jews. And he appealed to Caesar in Rome. If you ever appealed to Caesar, it was a Roman law. You had to be taken before Caesar. So Paul, on the end of his life, was taken this way here, and he went up here, and when he got over here in the neighborhood of Sicily, below Italy here, I always talk about the boot of Italy. It looks like a boot. That's why they call Italy the boot nation. looks like a boot, and Sicily is right down here. If you're in the Mafia, you have to be a Sicilian. You cannot be from Naples up here. In fact, I'm just giving you a little information. Al Capone was from Naples. He was not from Sicily. He couldn't be in the actual Mafia. But Sicily, that's Sicily right there. And Paul was shipwrecked on this island of Melita in the 28th chapter. Right there is where a serpent, he reached down and picked up a bunch of sticks. And right there on the island of Melita, that's where they shipwrecked, and Paul reached out to pick up some sticks. And the Mediterranean viper is a little short snake, and it latched onto his hand and hung on. It had curved fangs, and they would hang on and pump the venom in. And that's where they said of Paul, they said, he must be a god. His hand is not even swelling up, and he slung it in the fire. And that's what the 16th chapter of Mark is talking about. The apostles had the ability of handle serpents. These guys in East Tennessee, in Eastern Kentucky, they're idiots. When they handle serpents, they get bit, they die. When Jesus said that the apostles could take up serpents, he didn't mean you could take up serpents and hope you didn't get bit. If they got bit, they wouldn't be affected. But these guys in Eastern Kentucky, what they do is they keep their rattlesnakes cold. If you keep a rattlesnake real cold, it won't strike. But if you handle it till it warms up, he's going to bite you. So they be sure they get it back into a cold locker before they get bit. That's how they get by with that, and that's foolish. Jesus didn't say, and if you get bit, pray that you don't die. No. When Paul was bitten there on the island of Miletus, then he was taken up here to Rome, put in a house. In that last chapter, he was in a house under a guard of a Roman guard. And tradition says that they took him and they cut his head off. And when he was here at Rome, he wrote the book of Philippians. He wrote 2 Timothy, we know, from prison here. He sent a letter off to Philippi, and he sent a letter to Timothy down here when Timothy was at Ephesus, pastoring at Ephesus. And he said when he was in prison, I've learned, Philippians 4:11, I've learned. He said, I had to learn this. It's everything that we've been talking about tonight. He said, I've added to my faith. I've fought a good fight. I've finished the course. I've kept the faith. Henceforth, there's a crown of righteousness laid up for me, not for you only, but all those that love his appearing. He said, I've learned in whatsoever state I am, therewith to be content. When he said those words in Philippians 4:11, he was in a jail under guard by the Romans. He was an old man, about 67 A.D., and he was waiting to be executed. You don't learn to be content, autarkes. You don't learn that overnight. He was at the end of his life. He was old. He comes from auto and A-R-K-E-O. Auto is self. Archeo means to ward off. When you ward off something, you push it away. He said, I've learned to push away myself. I've learned to be virtuous, have knowledge. I've learned to be temperate. I've learned all these things to add to my faith. I'm an old man, and it's time to die. You're not going to learn this overnight. We have been given a cup to drink. That's why it's called suffering. Don't think, well, gosh, this is too hard, Jim. I have compassion for people when they tell me that. The fellow that talked to me yesterday, I had a lot of compassion for him. But I said, you have to go through it. There's no need in spinning some kind of yarn to him and making him think there's an easy way to go through this. There is not. I told him, I said, the best thing you can do is get in fellowship with the people of God. That's the best thing you can do. Read your Bible. Grow up. Quit resenting everything around you. The world is going to be the way it is. If all men drink iniquity like water and most of the world are vessels of wrath, why are you going to fight them? And why are you going to try to set them in their place? There's no need in doing that, is there? Nobody's going to fix the world. Let's live and go through it. That's all we can do. Isn't it? You want an easy way out of this? There's not one. You can't take your cross and die daily if by going to Arizona and building you a compound and crawling into a cave and never seeing anybody. How are you ever going to take a cross and die daily there? You're not. Preach to the lizards and the Gila monsters out there, I guess, and they'll bite you and kill you. I don't know. There's no easy way to do this. I know everybody, nobody, there's no one here that's different. Nobody's going to be here on the picnic on Saturday that's different. Everybody has everything in common. We're all just alike. You're not different. You make enemies of your family, I made enemies of mine. Mary made enemies of hers. People don't like you for telling the truth. People don't like us for telling the truth. You ought to get my emails. You ought to get them addressed to you. When you first start getting them, when I got them 25 years ago, I'll tell this guy, I'll write this here. Let's send this to him. Now I just say, leave him alone. We got a job to do. Our job is to stand in truth and witness all that we can and talk to people and fellowship with the people of God and learn to be strong in time. It's not going to happen quick. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for everything. God, help the church to mature. Everybody here is in the same boat and they don't even know it sometimes, Lord. They think they're different. None of us are different, Lord. This is the cup we have to drink. You've given it to us. We've got to grow up and mature and add to our faith, and thank you for that. Thank you for the fire, because that's what molds us into your likeness. Help us continue this work and open up the doors for the ministry. And God will praise you for everything and glorify you for all things that you do, including the evil, because it's for our good. Lead us to your elect family. In Christ's name we pray, amen. I'm sorry it's not easy, but it's not. God didn't give us an easy way through life. It's hard.
Richard Sheeman. If you go to Books of Me and you say, I want to order Richard Sheeman's books.
Who are you?
You're going to have an order. They're not always on the shelf.
When they picked it up, then it wasn't right off. It wasn't history. He was
somebody. He didn't know what he was doing.
This man came up, James Lowen.
James Lowen is good. Yes, he is. Yes. James Lowen. Richard Sheeman, and James.
Oh, Enjoy your time, Martin. Here, I'll see you.
Probably on Sunday.
Saturday.
Richard.
Oh, yeah, Friday.
That's why I couldn't drive.
I'm like, for how long? Y'all coming out?
Yeah, I think you should.
But I woke up with some John. Down.
James Lowen, he's got a book, he's got some good books. Lies my teacher told me, Richard sees a whole bunch of them. They probably have to order them, and then the shell.
They weren't.
We go say hello to Sheldon and Dave.
Okay.
The rest of the gang.
Hello, Richard Sheetman. He's got one called Presidential Ambition. He's got one, I love Paul Revere, whether he wrote or not. He's got one called Chair Slides and